നമസ്കാരം. ഇന്ന് നമ്മൾ മണി ടോക്സ് വെച്ചിട്ടുണ്ടെങ്കിൽ നമ്മളൊരു ഇന്റർവ്യൂ സീരീസ് ആയിട്ടാണ് വന്നേക്കുന്നത്. ഫസ്റ്റ് ഐ എം ജസ്റ്റ് ടോക്കിംഗ് ഇൻ മലയാളം, ജസ്റ്റ് ടു സെറ്റ് ദ കോണ്ടെക്സ്റ്റ് ക്ലിയർ. ഓക്കെ, സോ ടുഡേ വി ഹാവ് എൻ ഇന്റർവ്യൂ സീരീസ് വിത്ത് രാധിക ഗുപ്ത മാം. ഷീ ഈസ് എ സിഇഒ ഓഫ് എഡിൽവൈസ് മ്യൂച്വൽ ഫണ്ട്. ആൻഡ് എഡിൽവൈസ് മ്യൂച്വൽ ഫണ്ട് റീസെൻ്റ്ലി ഡൺ 1 lakh AUM. ആൻഡ് ഷീ ഈസ് എൻ ഓദർ. ഷീ ഈസ് a very good speaker. I have always seen you speak and got motivated from your stories. Then you are a social media influencer too, and you have done many talks. It's great to have you in the group, and I just wanted to showcase this book.
Thank you.
To all the people, and I'm sure that in Kerala audience, in Crosswords and everywhere, book is enough, you know, publicized, and the people are buying it. So it's a pleasure. It's really I take it as an honor to have you in our talk, and I'm sure that audience will definitely love this. Welcome.
Thank you. Namaskaram. That is the only bit of Malayalam I know, but delight to be in Cochin and to talk to you.
Okay. Thank you. Today we are going to talk about basic money lessons from you, and I have always seen that you speak a lot about personal finance, and you try to inspire people on some stories or other. And if I take you back to your schooling, and you have done schooling from different parts of the world, and worked in consulting firm, then you started your own fund, and it moved to Edelweiss, and now you are CEO of Edelweiss Mutual Fund. Could you please take us through this experience?
Sure. So my father is a diplomat. I always joke that my job is to sell mutual funds. His job was to sell India. So he served India in many, many different countries, and I grew up as a child with him. So I was born in Pakistan. I spent many years of my life in Africa, some in Europe, some in the US, and then I went abroad to study, and going to a good university is perhaps, whether in India or overseas, is a dream for many middle class Indians. I was able to realize that. And then I worked for a few years overseas, and I came back to India in 2009, and at that point perhaps coming back to India was not as popular as it is today, because India, the whole buzz around India growth story, etc., that you see today around Startup India, all these things was not there. But I'm very glad I came back. I ran my own business. I sold it to Edelweiss, and I have been building out the mutual fund business for us since 2017. I am fortunate that I have had the opportunity to take it from maybe a 5-6 thousand crore business to a 1 lakh odd crore business in the last 5-6 years. And that is an incredible opportunity that our industry gives you.
Okay, very good. And when you spoke about your personal life, and it was actually a kind of a realization for me myself, because you mentioned in your book that you were going through a bad phase, especially during the study times, having interviews missed it, and you try to do something. And when I was reading, or when I was listening, first thought it came to me is that who is that person to call and inform the police to do that? And next line you mentioned that your father is asked this question. Then I understood that I am in that your father's era, not in your era.
Okay. Correct.
So can you just take us through how do you handle failure? Because that is something which no one taught. And you are a good student. I understood that you are a really good student. Otherwise, you won't reach in that kind of school. And this is like just an interview, but that time it was a big thing. But how do you get out of it and come out and worked in MNC? How is that, Dini?
I think it's a very important question. The reason I have been so public in speaking about it is, and you're right, I was a very good student, a very ambitious student. Is that in India we are always told that you study hard, you work hard, and if you work hard, you'll get good grades in school, and then if you get good grades in school, you'll go to IIT, and then you'll get a good job and good wife and all that. But reality is, because we live in a country with so many numbers, if you work hard, despite working hard, sometimes things don't work out. And we are not taught to handle it. So I think the few things that I have learned is, one, it's very important to have open conversations when you're going through something like this. It's very important to seek help, to talk to people, and to realize that you are not the only person going through these things. It's when we hear public stories of people, we often see the more successful side, especially on social media platforms. But everyone has these stories. I do, but everybody you know has these stories. The second thing is, it is very important to know that when one door closes in life, another door opens, you know. So you don't, there's no only best college, only best job, only best promotion. You know, you don't be so much in love with something that if it doesn't happen, it feels like the world ends. Because the world doesn't end. There are so many opportunities. One door closes, five more doors open. We just have to go choose another door. Okay. And I always say I'm a product of not the first option, but the second option and the third option and the fourth option. And one of them has been a very good option. It was just not the first option.
Great. And you were really doing good in USA.
Mm-hmm.
Usually if you look at it, anyone who foreign educated, they got an opportunity, good job, they don't really want to come back. But you, you know, with your friends, you choose to come back here and set up something. Mm-hmm. And how did you see that India as an opportunity then? And you, if you can talk about this, especially this audience is great information.
I think this is a very important question. And to be honest, when I was 23, 24, at least my parents' generation would have felt that you've gone abroad, you've studied abroad, why come back? But I would recount it as one of the three best decisions of my life to come back to India. Because one thing that India gives you today is growth and opportunity. I think whether you are selling makeup or whether you are selling mutual funds, or whether you're advising clients on money, or whether you're building, you know, a beauty company or anything. In every domain today, there is opportunity. India in that sense is going to grow perhaps the fastest of any of its developed and emerging countries in the next 4 or 5 years. And this will create, as the title of my book is, truly limitless opportunities for anyone who wants to pursue a career, build a business. And that's what I thought. I don't think the opportunities that India has given me in the last 10 years, I would have ever gotten in that market. There's a lot that the US teaches you. There's a lot that a good education, working in the US or UK, that kind of thing teaches you. But, you know, we are lucky enough as young India to be working in an India of today, which offers so much growth. So to come back, bring all that and apply it here has been an incredible thing. And I would encourage everyone who's listening to think about that. It's not easy, I would also say that, because starting something, doing something is less glamorous than it appears. But I think if you do the hard yards, there's a lot of growth that can come out of it.
Okay. See, these days in social media, so many informations are there, and definitely success story means it will be there. If you are not talking, others will take your example and, you know, talk about it, right? And we have this thinking, if you look at youngsters, they will be working somewhere, but they will be thinking about said jobs. And even in, I have seen your LinkedIn post also, because more than their job, people are proud about what's the said job I'm doing and how I'm making this job, because my friend is doing startup. So how this younger generation really be happy or contented with what they have and build on that?
It's such a lovely point. And firstly, you know, I consider myself perhaps not a part of the young generation, but I also don't think I'm that old. And I think there's a lot that the young generation has in terms of opportunity and in terms of confidence that even my generation, you know, I mean, I'm 40 today, almost 40, that I didn't have when I was 20. So there's a lot that they have. Perhaps what you need to have is more patience. I always tell people, and I spoke about it in the book, that any entry-level job when you start is not the most exciting. You're not making big decisions. It has days of being boring. But you have to give each opportunity that you have time. You have to know that if you start a job or career there will be some work that you don't like, there will be some boss that you don't get along with. All of this will happen, but if you give it time, then you will feel, like in investments, as we say, you will feel the benefit of compounding over time. Compounding needs time, now in money or in career. So I think the thing is to give things time. There's also a lot of this conversation about younger generation doing side jobs, moonlighting, you know, etc. And it is a controversial topic, but I would say, you know, the opportunity that you have in front of you, whether it's a job you're working on or a business, give that 100%. Now, don't pursue something on the side. If you want to pursue something on the side that's better, quit this and give whatever you have 100%, because the world is so competitive that even when you give 100%, it is hard. So why do you believe that by giving 20% here and 60% here and 20% there, you'll be successful at any of the three?
Even we have a lot of talking about a 9-to-6 is not a place where you can, you know, be successful. And you need to be an business owner, you need to, you know, get into that one. Yeah. So what's your real take? Because you are successful, it is not so-called 9-to-6. But, you know, if you look at, you know, our category of people are so-called 9-to-6. So, how do you really talk to people?
You know, I have been an entrepreneur. I have run my own business. I have been an employee. In fact, when I sold the business to Edelweiss, people said, oh, you are going from being your own boss to someone else is going to be. And I think all of this is nonsense. I think entrepreneurship is a state of mind, not a state of employment. And these days, because there's such a startup climate in India, there's a belief that if you are working a job, if you're working 9-to-6, etc., you're not doing anything useful. I think that's totally not true. Startups are meant for some people. Working for someone else and building with someone else is meant for some people. I mean, it's okay. There is no judgment around this. I should also tell you that most of us who work in other organizations that are not our own don't work 9-to-6. I currently work from 9 to 5, 5:30. Then I spend 6 to 8 with my son, who's 7 months old. Yeah. And then I work from 10 to 12 at night. Yeah. Now, that's not a 9-to-6 life. It never has been a 9-to-6 life. So I don't think you can write off someone working. You choose what works for you. Some people want to take the risk that's associated with a startup. Some people want to work with someone else and build careers. I mean, Satya Nadella doesn't own Microsoft. Has he had any less glorious a career than anyone else? Of course he is not. I mean, has Deepak Parekh had less glorious a career because he is not the founder promoter of HDFC? No. So these are very convenient labels.
Okay. And if you look at it, we spoke about people who are entering into the job, and when they enter into the job, they are getting a salary. Whatever it is, they are getting a salary. There are people who fortunate to get big paycheck, but there are people who may not. So how do they start investing or save money, you know, from that early stage of their career?
So it is very important to start saving and investing early, because, you know, it is a habit that you should get into. And the other good thing about investing early is one makes mistakes while investing. It's good to make mistakes when you have less income, you know, as opposed to when you have larger income. I think SIP is a great way to start. Most of us are salaried professionals. So what I say is, after, take your post-tax income and have a target. I'm going to save 20% of it, 10% of it. And it doesn't matter if it's 2,000 rupees or 3,000 rupees or 5,000 rupees, and save it and invest it. And SIP will build a habit of investing. So just like tax is deducted every month, you know, some money will be deducted every month. And before you know it, that SIP that you started will build up in 5 years into something meaningful, and you'll be like, oh, where did this come from? I didn't know I was doing this. Yeah. So I think that is a great way to start. And if you're starting young, you know, you can do equity. You have time to give to. equity. So I think just putting a number that I'm going to save and invest 20% of my post-tax income, however small it is, and then as your income rises, take it up.
Great. When you spoke about how you spend your job and this one, so and in your book also you have clearly mentioned about work-life balance. You spoke, even I am seeing your post with son also, you are doing the interview, and lucky to him today he is not there. and another good point is about your husband, Nalin, and yeah, I become the fan of him. I told you.
I'll tell him that.
And you both are sitting in a very serious job and very responsible job as such, and you're managing your family, you're managing your child, and another fascinating thing about both of you is that you both have your own hobbies. The person who read your book will understand that the kind of books you read and the kind of movies you have. I was wondering that how this 40 years time you got that time to do that. And husband also doing Iron Man and stuff like that. So how do you really work it out, this one?
So I think one is I should not say it is easy. There are days when you are frustrated. There are days when you are overwhelmed. Ki bhai, ye sab, how am I going to do all this? This thought comes to mind. And I'm saying this because, you know, ever since I started writing, a lot of young women come to me and airports, or they write to me on LinkedIn, etc., saying I'm thinking of having a baby, but I want to be serious about my career and how is it all going to happen, and should I do it or should I not do it? And I want to tell you that it can all be done. One, you know, if you put your mind to it, it is very important, I believe, to have clear priorities. So I have learned to say no to a lot of things in life, because if you want to have a meaningful career and spend, and I spend a lot of time with my son, I mean a lot of time I try to take out, and you want to pursue hobbies, you have to say no to a lot of things. So I actually write down the things that are important to me in life, and everything that is not important then goes to the side. So some prioritization, some time management, and little bit of patience, and I think everything sort of happens. And you know, I was telling someone, for instance, that I travel a lot and I have a young son. Even when you travel, sometimes work travel can be a little mundane. And people say, oh, you have to travel, you have to take a domestic flight, you have to leave your child. I always try to find something fun in each of the cities I try to travel to. So Kochi is, of course, a beautiful city, so you just need to stare at the water here. But, you know, in other cities, you'll explore the food, or in some cities you'll buy sadis, which I love to do. So you have to find a way to make life harmonious, which is what I talk about in the book. You know, to find the fun in even the tougher elements of life, and then you are able to go on.
Great. And you this is a great thing, because a lot of people who reach 40s and 45, they see that they don't have time, they don't have time to pursue their hobbies, and so-called hobbies, it's out of their mind at all. And people who reach a mid-life, they would have spent in their career for, let's say, 10 years. And if you look at it, their salary, the first salary they have received, and today's salary, it definitely minimum 10 times.
Of course.
if it's 20 times. But their people saving how much? It may not be increased in the same proportion as what their income increased. How they, at this stage, if they have not done, or if they are doing it, how at the middle stage, how they think about money this time, and how they try to look at, because they have, time is less, responsibilities are coming.
Yeah.
So in that time, if they haven't started, how they really relook at in this journey?
See, I think when you move from your 20s to your 30s and 40s, in your 20s you have no liabilities. You can just spend, and you should start saving and investing. But by the time you come to your mid-30s, you really need to start being goal-oriented. So you need to think about, what is the income I'm earning today? What is the income I'm going to earn in the next 10 years? And what are the kind of goals and responsibilities I'm going to have? Now, for someone, it's caring for elderly parents. For someone like my husband and I had to buy a house, and Mumbai is a very expensive place. So that is goals. And you have to put goals, 5-year goals, 10-year goals, and you have to start linking your investments to goals. In fact, I heard this from an advisor in Kerala. I think it is worth even putting down a document of what your plan is, what your goals are, what you will do, what you will not do, and reviewing it every quarter and maybe re-looking at it and making amends and writing things down every year. So I think you have to go into that. If you start doing that in your 30s and early 40s, I think you'll feel a lot more comfortable. And then I think by your mid-40s, you also need to start thinking about planning retirement.
Okay.
You know, because that is also something that if you start planning retirement 2 years before you retire, really nothing is going to. And the good thing is today, courtesy funds, you have, once you have goals, you have financial products to meet all goals. So then it is just a matching exercise.
Okay. And you spoke about, identifying the goals and the setting up and everything. And mostly, we have a advisor community, people like us is doing that. And there are a lot of people think that, I don't have to go to advisor because it's not about, there are people think that I don't have enough money, so I don't have to go to. And with this money, how can I do it? There are many, many doubts. So what is that point that why do you need a consultant to talk about your money or and who is really should look at managing their money themselves? What's your take on that?
So I think very few people are actually those who should manage money themselves because one, people lack knowledge. Second, people lack time. You know, the reality is that we live very busy lives. I mean, you talked about work-life balance between our professions, our children, maybe hobbies that you want to pursue. Managing money is also a full-time task. And it just, we don't have time. And the question is, do you want to spend all day sitting and picking stocks or do you want to work with a professional? Now, it's interesting, if you hurt your knee, God forbid you don't, and you needed knee surgery, you would not say, I'm going to do this myself. I'm going to fix my knee myself. You would not say, I'm going to look up the answer on Google. You would say, I'm going to go to a professional. So this question is never asked of that. And I would say that is your physical health, but your financial health is also a very important part of health. So I think what an advisor can add most importantly is to personalize things for you. I mean, I spoke about goals. I think an advisor can sit with you and work on your goals, align your investments to your goals, and then as you change colors in your life, as you move from your 20s to your 30s to your 40s, also help you plan for the future. Because sometimes we are so busy in the day-to-day of our lives that we don't think about the future. So I think that's what an advisor can do.
Okay, good. And you spoke about in Kerala, if you look at it particularly our region, and I think in the rest of India also mostly, we go mainly on FDs, go mainly on gold especially, then we have a real estate. If you look at it, we have a belief that the real estate price will not go down. And what is your take on what is a good thing happening with this kind of belief and investing? What is a kind of improvement you can suggest?
Okay, so I'm not going to bash anything, but I'll just say a few things. I think one is, as far as real estate is concerned, you should not compare it to financial investments because it is not a liquid investment. There is no NAV of your house that is published every day. If it was published every day, believe me, it is as volatile as equities.
Correct.
But you just don't get an NAV, so you don't know about
NAV
that.
Means daily price.
Daily price. So you don't get a daily price. If someone send you in the newspaper that your house has this price every day and it's minus 5% and 2%, you'd feel equally stressed about your house. So that is that. Now, as far as FD is concerned, I know traditionally it has given people a large sense of security, especially here. I would only tell people that do remember two things. One is FD finally does not create wealth. You have to look at wealth creating instruments. We are living in an India where nominal economic growth will probably be 11-12% minimum. Economic GDP will grow at 6% plus inflation. So if you want to benefit from the growth of the economy, real companies, a new generation is getting more aspirational, then some component of equity needs to be in your portfolio. The second thing, so you have to have some part of equity. And I always say that you don't need to move 100% from FD to equity. You can make gradual steps. Thankfully, also the mutual fund industry today Like my personal favorite product is not an equity product, it's not a debt product. It's a product that is a mix of both. Yeah. I've talked about it in my book also, the Balanced Advantage Fund, that has some amount of equity upside and some amount of downside protection. So I think once you open your mind, there are a lot of options. The second thing I would tell you is that for many investors, we are always talking about tax saving in India. Every time the budget comes, we're all sitting as the FM said this time, how much tax are we going to save? FD investors are fully tax paying investors. And if you are a fully tax paying investor, it's also important to realize that mutual funds have something called debt funds. And we happen to be one of the leaders in this space that offer solutions at significantly better taxation than your current FD structure. So every year we are asking the finance minister to give us a tax break, yet we comfortably invest in something where we are fully taxed when better alternatives are available. So I think my net message is open your mind to newer ideas.
Okay. Even when it comes to FD here, we go for FD, what is the return percentage we are getting? And there are times we look for FDs with much 2% or 3% higher than what you get it in nationalized bank. Yeah. So which means looking for 9%, 8% kind of a return, because they don't want to go for, they want to get the equity return, but they don't want to take that kind of equity. Stock market is subject to market risk. So what is your take on going for FDs with higher percentage of interest available? Higher means 9%, 8% kind of a thing.
You know, I would tell you, ask you a question that when you are, what is an FD? You're finally lending money to someone. When you're lending money to someone at 7% versus lending to someone at 9%, that 2%, finally the borrower that is borrowing from you is very different. And the risk is very different. My only, and you don't understand, most people don't understand that risk. My only point is, if you want to take that risk, you should take it in equity. Yeah. You should not take it in debt, because I've seen, whether in the US or India, when things go wrong in FDs, see, when you invest FD money, you want real security. At least when you invest in equity, you are ready to take risk. So when things go wrong in debt or in secured instruments, you get very stressed. You almost feel a loss of trust. So if you want to take that risk, then please go take it in equity. If you want safety, then do the safest instrument for safety.
And we spoke about mutual fund. In our audience, everyone knows mutual fund. But even then, can you tell that what is mutual fund in 30 seconds?
In 30 seconds. So I think mutual fund is a way to get your money professionally managed in the most regulated vehicle that exists in India. So with extreme regulation, transparency and comfortable cost, it's a way to get your money professionally managed. Yeah. And it can be professionally managed. And there is a myth that mutual fund means risk and mutual fund means equity. There are all kinds of mutual funds. Mutual funds can give you exposure to the 50 largest stocks in India or the 200 smallest stocks. They can give exposure to they can give FD-like exposure. They can give exposure to gold. They can give exposure to Chinese tech companies. That is the range of what you can get as a mutual fund investor sitting in India today.
Okay. And when we speak about FD and mutual fund, we have debt products, right? So what is debt product, and we have something called passive debt products also. And could you just take us through that?
So I'm going to take you through one debt product, which I think is the most meaningful for this audience, which is a passive debt product called target maturity funds. We launched the first one in India that some people will at least know, called Bharat Bond. And what it is this is a debt product where you buy bonds and you hold them till maturity. It's very simple. So they are called target maturity funds, which means they have a maturity date. So a maturity date could be 2025, it could be 2030, it could be 2035. So there is a year in which it matures. If you buy a 2030 fund, then what the fund manager will do, they will buy bonds maturing in 2030 and just sit and hold them till maturity. For you as an investor, what that means is, if you invest today in a 2030 product and it says the yield is say 7.5%, that's what the mutual fund company tells you, if you don't do anything for the next 7, 8, 10 years, whatever, till 20, 30 years, you will get that. So there is that predictability of return. What bonds are these? These are bonds of either GSEC, Government of India, states backed by Government of India, or AAA public sector enterprises like REC or PFC or NABARD. So really the safest quality instruments, you buy bonds, you hold them till maturity, and these products are very slim in terms of costs as well. So it's giving you an FD-like experience, but the taxation is significantly better than FD.
Okay. So it's match to match in FD and taxes, you have a...
Tax, you pay 20% tax minus the rate of inflation. So effectively it comes out to be 10% tax versus 30% tax.
Okay. So and we have a lot of NRI audience, right? So NRI, we have a lot of people have invested significant money in FDs. And there are a lot of people invested in FCNR.
Mm-hmm.
And there are a lot of people are worried about the currency fluctuation going on. So for those kind of audience, what is your take on, advice on mutual fund investment opportunity in India?
Sure. So I think for NRIs, and I have been an NRI for some part of my life myself, for NRIs who want to come back to India. See, if you are an NRI, there are some assets you will build in US dollars. Now that you can build via FCNR, or you can build by investing in whichever country you're in, whether it's US, Dubai or whatever, you will build some foreign currency assets. But if you want to come back to India, it is very important to build an asset pool in India. And actually today, even if you don't want to come back or you're unsure, India as an equity market offers very, very high growth. If you want to come back, definitely there's a case to build assets in India because you need rupee money. So for an NRI, I would, one, highly recommend mutual funds. A lot of NRIs do very complicated things. I mean, you spoke about my husband, his entire family is NRIs. So, you know, they'll buy property in India, they'll buy some direct stock portfolio, they'll do XYZ. And then sitting abroad and maintaining that portfolio is a total nightmare because you can't manage the property maintenance issues, you can't manage something going wrong. So NRI investments have to be highly regulated and highly simple. That's my one request to NRIs, and I think mutual funds do the job very well.
Okay. And normally, you know, when we look at, you know, our portfolio asset, even in your case also, you have a Chinese fund, you have a US fund,
yes,
and everything. So what is the kind of proportion? Because even a lot of advertisement is there. You can invest for zero paisa, for invest in direct stocks.
Mm-hmm.
And you sitting here don't even know. You only know something called Facebook and
correct.
You know the account. I don't know what is happening with that company. And we have a beautiful product in mutual fund. There is someone who is managing for us. We only know the fund name, but someone is managing it. So what is the kind of allocation? Which allocation means how, for example, I'm investing 1 lakh rupees SIP in mutual fund. How much percentage I should invest in this kind of international funds?
So I would say, and we are one of the largest providers of international funds in the industry, 10 to 15% is a good medium-term allocation. However, I would say you should do this when you have experienced domestic equity. You can't move from investing in FD to investing in US and China funds. Pehle aap, you do domestic equity, you understand equity market. See, because what happens, as you said, na, is if something goes wrong in China or the US, you have no idea. Your knowledge is limited. If something goes wrong in India, you understand India. So first build your domestic equity, domestic debt portfolio. Over time, you can add 10-15% allocation. For instance, in my own portfolio, I have SIPs running into international funds. I have one US fund and I have one emerging markets or China fund. I would just make one more point on direct stocks. It's hard enough to pick direct stocks in your home market to pick them overseas. And I think with the recent budget, picking stocks overseas through LRS has a 20% withholding tax. So it becomes very complicated. In mutual funds, it's as simple as investing 5,000 rupees today.
And you have a talk about a balanced fund, right? And we have this fund, and which is giving certain kind of less volatile, less risk, we can say the risk or volatile, I don't know, we will understand. It's fluctuation is less. So who should really look for this kind of funds? And for example, there are people who are investing, let's say, 2 lakh rupees or 10,000 SIP. What is your take on this kind of fund should come in their portfolio?
So I think balanced advantage fund is like the Indian thali. It's good for most of us. You know, it's like the dal rice of our life, or the curd rice, or whatever, dal roti, and whatever you call in different regions. I am, by the way, 60-70% of my investments go into our own balanced advantage fund. I'll tell you why. Because what do most people want with investing? They want some growth and some downside protection. And I think a balanced advantage fund gives you that. It has equity, it has debt. The fund manager and the team decide how to allocate between equity and debt. So it gives you a very good outcome. I should share something. I've been doing an SIP into our own balanced advantage fund for the last 7 years. Quietly, I just do the SIP. I have realized a return of 14% compounded year on year, just sitting quietly and doing nothing. By just doing monthly SIPs that get deducted from my salary. I think for most of us, whether it's 14 or 12, these are good outcomes. So I think a balanced fund is good for people who want to experiment with equities, who are making a move from FD, for instance, but they don't want to do full equities. They can start with a balanced fund. For retiring people who want some equity but some conservatism, then they can take money out. And for many people like me who are conservative investors also.
Okay. And, you know, from the questions and, we have discussed, many things. What is your, final advice for Kerala audience as such in terms of managing their money?
I think Kerala audience is one of those sort of, it's a very forward-looking state. It's a very educated state. And I, by the way, every time I come here, I'm amazed at the role of women and how forward they are in this state. I'm always impressed. I think the message is that today India offers you so much in terms of opportunity and financial opportunity in a very regulated way. You know, so you're not entering into something that is unregulated or unsafe. If you open your mind and just gradually explore these things, then you will see more opportunities for your portfolio. So I think that is the request.
Okay. And, usually when I talk to, a person like you, I don't really go with a woman type of question, because I feel that you are an inspiration for every gender. But what is your advice to women in terms of their role in the family finance? I think that will be a good advice from your side.
You know, if I was sitting in any other state in India, I would answer this question. But having come here multiple times, I actually will take what I have seen in Kerala and give that advice to other parts of the world. Because the one thing I'm seeing when I'm talking to advisors here, women are involved in money. Women are financially independent in Kerala. Most women are involved in financial decisions, at least much more than other parts of the country. So I think women in Kerala are an inspiration. So I'm not going to give advice. I'm going to take the example and say, continue what you are doing and export the advice from Kerala.
It's a great appreciation to our audience and the our family members too, because I always take pride in saying that my grandmother, my mother, even my wife, everyone take decent respect to the money, and they are independent in terms of money, and they kind of not advise, order us what to do with the money.
So this story should be told. We are not ones to give advice, we are ones to take advice.
Thank you. And it's a great opportunity for me personally and my audience as such. The kind of knowledge which you have shared, I always feel that this is an opportunity to get mended from your experience, and you have seen different world, and I just appreciate your time taken for early morning today, and spend time for this. Thank you so much.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Yeah.